भाई गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल, वेलकम टू क्लास 12th इकोनॉमिक्स। आईडी चैप्टर नंबर 1 इंडियन इकोनॉमी ऑन द ईव ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस इज गोइंग ऑन एंड वी हैव ऑलरेडी स्टडीड द स्टेट ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर ऑन द ईव ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस। देन वी हैव स्टडीड द स्टेट ऑफ इंडस्ट्रीज ऑन द ईव ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस। यस्टरडे वी वर डूइंग द स्टेट ऑफ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ऑन द ईव ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस and as well as this state of demographic profile also we have covered. So we were doing state of infrastructure on the eve of independence, where I've already told you that Indian Britishers in India, they made roadways first. Remember, they made roadways first. They made roadways so that the muddy roads can be converted into cemented roads, into highways, and ultimately the British goods can be provided at every corner of the country India. When they thought now people are getting our products demand high and we can export, we can provide them more and more goods, but it's not possible to provide all the goods at every corner of the country through roadways, because now the demand was more and people were creating more and more demand at very sooner stage. So Britishers decided to start the railways also in India. So they started the railways in India. 1850 they made a proposal, they introduced the railway in India in 1850, and 1854 the first bridge from Mumbai to Thane, the first railway Bombay to Thane was started. Then railway basically covered the whole India from Jammu and Kashmir to Kanyakumari, from Gujarat to Arunachal Pradesh. At every corner of the country India, they basically introduced railway. Now again, the demand created more. People were now, they wanted to have more products of Britain because they were like enjoying British goods, because that was the new demand, new variety of goods. So Britishers also thought that now as the demand have increased, now they should import more and more from Britain, England to India. They should, do something that they can get more and more imports from Britain at very high rates. I mean, very faster rate. For that, they introduced the Suez Canal. 1869. I have already shown you the Suez Canal also yesterday, the map. They introduced this Suez Canal. Suez Canal was basically introduced by Britishers to lower the gap of England and India, so that earlier, like Britishers have to come from the various things, like they have to cover up from North Pole to South Pole, covering the South Africa, and they have to, through the African ports, they have to come to India. That was the longest route for them, as it was creating a time gap in the demand and the fulfillment of the demand for those products. So they thought of opening a waterway, artificial waterway, which can decrease the gap or decrease the distance of England and India. So they used the Mediterranean Sea, which was connected with Iran, Iraq. They used that route and they made up a new waterway, artificial waterway on the Mediterranean Sea, which was connecting the England ports to Indian ports directly through that route. So ultimately that route almost reduced the 7,000 kilometers, and which was a well-known policy, which was a well-known canal made by the Britishers worldwide in India. It was popular as a very most strategic canal made by the Britishers. And this way, they basically introduced the railway, ports, roadways to exploit India. But along with the roadways, railways and ports, they introduced post and telegraph also in India. Post and telegraph they introduced for enhancing the administrative efficiency in India. They wanted to take the orders. Ki haan bhai, us state se kitna order aa raha hai, us jagah se kitna order aa raha hai. For taking the orders and telling them about order fulfillment, they must have some connectivity. So they introduced post and telegraph. Telegraph ke jariye, post ke jariye, उनको ऑर्डर वगैरह जो थे वो मिलने देने उन्होंने स्टार्ट किए, कि उस एरिया से ऑर्डर मिलना शुरू हुआ, ऑर्डर देना स्टार्ट किया, तो फुलफिलमेंट की डेट बताई, टाइम बताया, सो दैट कि वो मैनेज कर सके पूरे एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन. ओके, सो व्हाट इज द इम्पैक्ट ऑफ रेलवेज इन इंडिया? लेट्स सी रेलवेज, व्हाट इम्पैक्ट रेलवे इज प्रोवाइडिंग इन इंडिया. यू नो, रेलवे हैज बीन अ वेरी ग्रेट अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर इंडिया. रेलवे हैज बीन अ वेरी पॉजिटिव इम्पैक्ट फॉर इंडिया. बट व्हाट इम्पैक्ट रेलवे इज प्रोवाइडिंग, दैट वी आर नाउ गोइंग टू स्टडी, कि रेलवे एक्चुअली में क्या इम्पैक्ट देता है या क्या इम्पैक्ट रेलवे ने हम लोगों को दिया. अगर इफ यू टॉक अबाउट द पॉजिटिव इम्पैक्ट ऑफ रेलवे, तो वील सिंपली से इन द पॉजिटिव इम्पैक्ट ऑफ रेलवे दैट इज फैसिलिटेटेड एक्सपेंशन ऑफ डोमेस्टिक मार्केट. ब्रिटिशर्स के लिए डोमेस्टिक मार्केट एक्सपैंड हो गई, नॉट फॉर द ब्रिटिशर्स बट ऑल्सो फॉर मैनी पीपल. नाउ विद द रेलवे एनी इंडिविजुअल कुड, यू नो, दे कुड विजिट द अदर प्लेसेस, दे कुड विजिट द अदर मार्केट्स एंड ग्रैब द अपॉर्चुनिटीज देयर. दे कुड बाय द प्रोडक्ट्स फ्रॉम द अदर मार्केट्स विच आर स्पेशलाइज इन सम काइंड ऑफ प्रोडक्ट्स. कमर्शलाइजेशन ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर, रेलवे के आने से कमर्शलाइजेशन को और बूस्टअप मिला. कमर्शलाइजेशन मतलब जब आप बनाते हो सामान, एग्रीकल्चर प्रोड्यूस कर रहे हो, नॉट फॉर जस्ट योर ओन सब्सिस्टेंस फार्मिंग और सेल्फ फार्मिंग, बट ऑल्सो फॉर मेकिंग इट पॉपुलर, यू नो, इन द मेकिंग इट सेल इन द मार्केट एंड अर्न सम मनी आउट ऑफ दैट. सो इट वॉज नॉट पॉसिबल फॉर द फार्मर्स टू टेक देयर फार्मिंग टू द अदर स्टेट्स ऑफ द कंट्री and not just to sell in their own state, but they could take the help of railway, they could grab the opportunity by that, they could transfer their material to the other states, and they can easily, they could earn the money from that also. Enabled people to break barriers of distance. You know, earlier, jab railways were not there, roadways not properly built up, so people were not having any opportunity to go to other states and to you know, grab the opportunity or get the employment from the other state. But now with the railway, it was now possible. It was now possible for them because railway has, of course, it has broken the barriers of distance. Now people could easily move from one place to another. They could easily transfer from one place to another, and they could, of course, earn the money by that, and they could visit the places, different places, and they could meet different people with the help of railway. Faster movement of food grains across different parts of the country. Famines ko control karne mein railway bahut madad kiya. Famines ko control karne mein. Pehle kya hota tha, jis area mein famine hota tha, udhar khana pahunchana bahut mushkil ho jata tha. But now with the railway, we could easily control the famines. We could easily provide the material, food material or any other material which is required to the those places which were famine affected. So faster movement of food grains across different parts of country was observed, that people could easily, you know, transfer the goods also from one place to another, and they could easily control the famines also. But we had some negative impact also of the railway. Contributed to colonial exploitation. Obviously, railways, making of railways has given us the positive impacts, no doubt. But the main motive of making the railway in India by the Britishers was just to exploit the Indian people, was just to grab the Indian market, was just to provide their Britain goods in India. So it contributed to the colonial exploitation, that we were more exploited by Britishers now with the help of railway, because with the railway, they were providing faster movement of goods to the other states of the country, cancelling or removing the use of handicrafts and providing their machine-made goods only to the different parts of the country. Destroyed indigenous goods market, jo hamari apni India ki goods market thi, usko destroy kar diya railway. Because through the railway, the Britishers were using railways for providing the bulk quantity of goods to the different parts of the country, which of course destroyed our Indian market. Because now people were not able to, they were not liking the Indian handicrafts. They were liking the Britain goods only. Ek to they were provided faster rate than handicrafts, cheaper than handicrafts, and of course a new pattern of demand was in the Britain goods as compared to Indian goods. Spread of domestic market for British products. So it was used, railway was used to spread the domestic market for the British products only. So that was the impact of infrastructure, state of infrastructure on the eve of independence. इंडिपेंडेंस के टाइम पे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर कैसा था. यू हैव टू टॉक अबाउट रोडवेज जो मैंने बता दिया, यू हैव टू टॉक अबाउट रेलवेज जो मैंने बता दिया, यू हैव टू टॉक अबाउट दी पोर्ट्स. पोर्ट्स के अंदर स्पेशली यू हैव टू टॉक अबाउट स्विस कैनाल व्हिच डिक्रीज्ड द डिस्टेंस ऑफ इंग्लैंड एंड इंडिया एंड अल्टीमेटली इट रिड्यूस्ड ऑलमोस्ट 7000 किलोमीटर्स एंड मेड इट पॉसिबल टू प्रोवाइड गुड्स एट फास्टर रेट फ्रॉम इंग्लैंड टू इंडिया. Now let's talk about the next state, that is state of foreign trade under British rule. Let's see how was the foreign trade under British rule. We are now watching out how was the foreign trade under British rule. What do you think? We were doing foreign trade with which country? Were we doing foreign trade with many countries under British rule? Our maximum monopoly of trade, of foreign trade, was with the Britain only. Maximum trade we were doing with the Britain only. What about trade ka which we were doing from Iraq, Iran, Saudi Arabia, I mean United States, Emirates, Arab Emirates. Otherwise, maximum trade we were just doing with the Britain only. So Britain had a monopoly control over India's foreign trade. Britain had a monopoly control over India's foreign trade. But the point arises, what kind of foreign trade we were doing with the other countries. We were just the next net exporter. Exporter matlab bhejna. We were just the net exporter of primary products. Primary products here means raw material. And importer of finished goods. Hum kya karte the, aap aise samjho. Hum normal wood bhejte the. We were exporting wood, raw clothes, kapda, khali kapda, bane hue clothes nahi, not shirts, not trousers, not suits. We were just exporting raw clothes, a piece of cloth. We were just exporting that. We were exporting raw wood, khali ek lakdi, but not the finished goods from the wood. Like we were not exporting the furniture. We were just exporting the raw wood. Same way, raw wool, raw jute, indigo, sugar. We were exporting these things. But what we were importing? We were importing, of course, woolen clothes. Britishers ke yahan pe famous the woolen clothes. Wo bahut acche banate the woolen clothes. Aapne dekha bhi hoga movies wagaira mein. जिसमें वो दिखाते हैं ब्रिटिशर्स दैट द पीपल आर वेयरिंग लॉन्ग जैकेट्स, वूलन जैकेट्स. तो वी वर वी स्टार्टेड इंपोर्टिंग दोज वूलन क्लोथ्स फ्रॉम ब्रिटेन. वी स्टार्टेड इंपोर्टिंग सम रेडीमेड क्लोथ्स लाइक शर्ट्स, ट्राउजर्स, सूट्स, जीन्स फ्रॉम ब्रिटेन. वी स्टार्टेड इंपोर्टिंग सिल्क क्लोथ्स, कॉटन क्लोथ्स फ्रॉम Britain, and ultimately this way we were double exploited. What they were doing? They were importing raw material from India at very low rate. Wo India se raw material saste mein khareed rahe the. Raw material they were converting into finished products in Britain. Britain mein that raw material they people were converting into finished products in Britain, and ultimately they were selling those finished products in India only at very high rates. और वही goods वो इंडिया में आके बेच रहे थे high rates के ऊपर. जिसका मतलब है they were double exploiting India. Two fold motive of Britishers to double exploit India. India's monopoly control of foreign trade was with the Britain only. Because more than 50% foreign trade directed towards the Britain itself. 50% क्या, I would say almost 80-90% was foreign trade was being done with the Britain only. जो थोड़ा बचा trade जो बचा था वो हम कर रहे थे foreign trade with Iran और with Iraq और with Arab Emirates. जो थोड़ा बहुत trade बचा था. Otherwise the maximum foreign trade we were doing with the Britain only. अब you know Britain was earning very good amount. यस, ब्रिटेन वॉज अर्निंग वेरी गुड अमाउंट फ्रॉम इंडिया थ्रू द फॉरेन ट्रेड. सस्ते में ले रहा था रॉ मटेरियल, महंगे में बेच रहा था फिनिश गुड्स, तो प्रॉफिट तो होगा, सरप्लस तो होगा. जितना भी सरप्लस हो रहा था, क्योंकि क्या था उस पॉइंट पे, जितना भी सरप्लस ट्रेड इंडिया में हो रहा था, दैट वॉज ओनली इन द बेनिफिटिंग टू ब्रिटेन, बिकॉज ब्रिटेन उस पैसे को यूज कर रहा था, एक्स्ट्रा पैसे को यूज कर रहा था वॉर एक्सपेंसेस पे. ब्रिटेन का जिस जिस के साथ वॉर होता था वो पैसा वॉर में खर्च कर रहा था, और इट वॉज यूजिंग दैट मनी इन द फैक्ट्रीज ऑफ ब्रिटेन, वो ब्रिटेन की फैक्ट्रीज में उसको यूज कर रहा था. एंड अल्टीमेटली इट वॉज अ ह्यूज ड्रेन ऑफ वेल्थ फ्रॉम इंडिया. इंडिया की वेल्थ में एक ह्यूज ड्रेन था. ड्रेन मतलब हमारा सारा पैसा निकल के जस्ट जा रहा था. कहाँ जा रहा था? ब्रिटेन में जा रहा था. एंड वी वर नॉट हैविंग मनी, लैक ऑफ मनी इन इंडिया वॉज वेरी बैड. लेकिन इंडिया का बैलेंस ऑफ ट्रेड अच्छा सरप्लस शो कर रहा था. बैलेंस ऑफ ट्रेड मतलब आर एक्सपोर्ट्स वर मोर देन इंपोर्ट्स. इसका मतलब है इंडिया को सरप्लस हो रहा था, प्रॉफिट हो रहा था. बट दैट प्रॉफिट, हु वाज टेकिंग दैट प्रॉफिट? ब्रिटेन वाज टेकिंग दैट प्रॉफिट. व्हाई? बिकॉज इट वांटेड टू यूज दैट मनी ऑन वॉर एक्सपेंसेस, इट वांटेड टू यूज दैट मनी ऑन इट्स एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, इट वांटेड टू इन्वेस्ट दैट मनी इन ब्रिटेन इटसेल्फ इन वेरियस फैक्ट्रीज. Got my point, Ankita? Got my point? Okay, so that was foreign trade on the eve of independence. Foreign trade on the eve of independence. आपने ध्यान क्या रखना है? Main trade was being done with the Britain itself. Few countries were there. We were just making foreign trade with them also. Otherwise, maximum monopoly trade was in the hands of Britain. And what trade we were doing? Exporting raw material and importing finished products. This way, India was double exploited and Britain was fulfilling its twofold motive. Our India's foreign trade was showing surplus. BOP was in surplus. Exports were more than imports. But that surplus was used by the Britain only for these purposes. Got my point? Now, moving further, demographic, so we have already covered. Now, the last stage of this chapter, because iske baad we'll have only one topic left, that will be the positive effects and negative effects of Britishers in India of colonial period. But this is one of the last topic of the state of Indian economy, that is occupational structures on the eve of independence. Like we have covered agriculture state on the eve of independence, state of industries on the eve of independence, demographic profile on the eve of independence, infrastructure on the eve of independence, foreign trade on the eve of independence, five yoga, and six is last, occupational structure on the eve of independence. That means we'll study that how many people are working, were working in which field, kitne log kaun si field mein kaam kar rahe the. This is about this concept. Agriculture, the principal source of occupation. See, the principal source of occupation was agriculture in India. Almost 75% people were working on the agriculture as a primary activity. 75% people jo the for the primary activity, they were working in the agriculture. India mein 72% se jyada log kaam kar rahe the agriculture pe, jabki US mein sirf 2% karte hain. Japan 12%, जर्मनी 4%. तो आप सोच सकते हैं इंडिया कितना आउटडेटेड रह चुका है उस टाइम. दैट मोर पीपल वर जस्ट एंगेज इन द एग्रीकल्चर फॉर द एम्प्लॉयमेंट, नॉट ऑन द मैन्युफैक्चरिंग और द दैट थर्ड सर्विस इंडस्ट्री. इंडस्ट्री सेक्टर, इफ यू टॉक अबाउट द सेकेंड फेज, द सेकेंडरी सेक्टर, ऑलमोस्ट 15% पीपल वर देयर इन द इंडस्ट्रियल सेक्टर, दे वर वर्किंग. Almost 15%. They were working in the industrial sector, that is the manufacturing sector. And if we talk about the third, that is the tertiary sector or service sector, 10% people only were working in the tertiary sector. So 75% primary sector for the employment, 15% secondary sector for the employment, to 12% tertiary sector, service sector for the empire. This was the state of this occupational structure on the eve of independence. This shows that our country was so outdated, the technologies were outdated, that people had to depend upon the agriculture only for the survival, for the food, for the employment. And our country was unskilled labor, was having unskilled labor. That is why people were uneducated and they were just getting themselves into the agriculture field only. They were not in any skilled job, like in the factories or in the industrial sector or in the tertiary sector. So they were basically having the unskilled job opportunities because their people were unskilled. They were not educated. And poverty was widespread, due to which people had no other option just to engage themselves into the primary source of employment, that is primary sector only. Got my point? So this is about the occupational structure on the eve of independence. Now, if I talk about the brief way that what was the condition of Indian economy on the eve of independence, agar main ek brief way mein bolun, so of course our economy was stagnant economy. Stagnant means that there was no growth or very little growth in the economy because of bulk of population and low standard of living. Starvation was there, epidemics, pandemics were taking place, due to which our economy was just a stagnant economy. There was no growth in the economy. Our economy was backward also. Our economy was having the agricultural backwardness due to various reasons which I have just already told you in the agriculture sector on the eve of independence. We were having the industrial backwardness also. We were not having the machines. The machines were almost negligible. Small and cottage industries thi, wo bhi bahut zyada small thi, low level pe kaam karti thi, almost ruined it. Wo bhi source of employment ki achhi nahi thi. And if we talk about the capital goods, gaadiyan, machineries, engine, bade bade goods, tractors, agar ikka dukka kisi ke paas hote bhi the, to we were just dependent on the Britain. ब्रिटेन लाकर देगा इंग्लैंड से हमें, वहीं से ब्रिटेन लाकर देगा हमें, तो हम लोग उसको यूज कर पाए. वी वर हैविंग रैम्पेंट पॉवर्टी दैट टाइम इन इंडिया. रैम्पेंट पॉवर्टी, वाइड स्प्रेड अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट एंड इलिटरेसी, वाइड स्प्रेड पॉवर्टी इन इंडिया, पुअर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, एक्सट्रीमली लो कम्युनिकेशन मीन्स एंड ट्रांसपोर्ट इन इंडिया, एक्सट्रीमली लो. कम्युनिकेशन के नाम पे कुछ भी नहीं, ट्रांसपोर्ट के नाम पे कुछ भी नहीं. वो तो बाद में ब्रिटिशर्स स्टार्टेड द रेलवेज एंड इंप्रूव द रोडवेज, अदरवाइज वी वर नॉट हैविंग एनी इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर इन इंडिया. बिजली का तो कितने स्टेट्स में तो बिजली का नामो निशान तक नहीं होता था. देर वर नो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एट ऑल, नो एक्सेस टू इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एट ऑल. देन हैवी डिपेंडेंस ऑन इम्पोर्ट्स for machinery, for equipments, medicine, bicycle, cars, sewing machines, kerosene oil. We were just dependent upon imports only. British will give us, Britain will give us, because we were not having these things in our country. Nobody was educated, nobody was having the skills to make these things. Ultimately, there was no other option just to get dependent upon the Britain. So we were completely dependent upon British for all these things. Limited urbanization. If we talk about urban areas, only 14% lived in the urban areas. Otherwise, 86% people were just in the rural areas, backward areas. Of course, creating lack of opportunities at widespread, because the people have no other option outside the agriculture. They had just only option of agriculture, or wo bhi aisa option that many people were working on the same field. Then semi feudal economy, neither wholly feudal or nor a capitalist, due to low production. Hamari economy semi feudal thi, na to hamari economy puri tarah capitalist thi, na hi hamari economy puri tarah feudal thi. सोशलिस्ट थी, एक सेमी फ्यूडल इकोनॉमी थी, लो प्रोडक्शन होता था, सब लोग कम चीजों में गुजारा कर लेते। एंड ऑफ कोर्स हमारी इकोनॉमी को कलोनियल इकोनॉमी भी कहा गया। व्हाई कलोनियल इकोनॉमी? बिकॉज वी वर एक्सप्लॉयटेड बाय द कलोनियल गवर्नमेंट, वी वर एक्सप्लॉयटेड बाय द ब्रिटेन गवर्नमेंट, क्रिएटिंग अ लॉट ऑफ प्रॉब्लम्स फॉर इंडिया। सो दीज वर द फीचर्स ऑफ इंडियन इकोनॉमी ऑन द ईव ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस। Then that all we have covered now: industrial, agriculture, demographic, occupation, foreign trade, infrastructure. Now the last topic would be there, that is about positive impacts and negative impacts, positive impacts and negative impacts of Britishers in India. The Britishers' ke positive or negative impacts kya the India? Of course, that we will be doing in the next class.